submission. Why would anyone within the claimant go to such lengths to conceal payments they had agreed to make? For apparently proper purposes, from essentially themselves and the regulator of their parent. Page 290 of Exhibit JP6, which Your Honour will find in volume in bundle 2. This is a legitimate Lincoln Associates invoice. It's dated the 30th of May of 2013. It gives in the top left-hand corner a post office box address for Lincoln Associates. It gives the Lincoln, shows the Lincoln Associates logo. It's a very short form invoice. Timesheets attached for two individuals, and then Your Honour sees bank details. Please make the payment for this invoice no later than 13th of June, so it's a 14-day invoice. And Your Honour sees account name Lincoln Associates, account number 07010123-001.
Great difficulty is if I have the right page, it's barely legible.
I'm sorry. But the IBAN number may be easier.
Is that the page I should be looking at?
Sorry?
Is that what I should be looking at?
No. Sorry. JP6, oh, I see, then this is compliant with set of
numbers.
JP6274.
Yeah, different set of numbers. Right.
Yes, I think I will just use JP6 numbers. It's better. As Your Honour might appreciate, these documents have been exhibited a number of times in different contexts. So JP6274, and Your Honour sees the genuine Lincoln Associates invoice.
Yes.
And Your Honour sees the way it's laid out, and Your Honour sees the account into which payment is requested.
Yep.
Can I now ask Your Honour to turn to JP6293. Your Honour sees it's essentially the same document except the account number has become 0353601. 486131. And you are also notes stamps in two places approved David Haigh. This is dated the this bears the date 30th of April of 2013. So a month before. But Your Honour will appreciate, unless one is examining the account number, these two invoices are indistinguishable in layout. Can I now ask Your Honour to turn, please, to page 2, JP6295. And Your Honour sees again, this one's 31st of July of 2013, is the date of the bears. This time the account number is 09007332-050. So three different invoices within 3 months of each other, bearing three different account numbers, but unless one is focused on those account numbers, appearing to be from exactly the same supplier. We'd invite Your Honour to conclude that this is an exercise done with care.
If one goes back to page 293, it's what looks like a purported signature of Mr. Sinclair, unless that should be attributed to stamped in some way.
293 is David Haigh's signature.
That's Mr. Haigh, that's signature, right, okay.
Now whether that is put there by Mr. Haigh personally is a matter of dispute. We say he put it there. But the really important point is somebody has taken the time and trouble to create a Lincoln Associates invoice seeking payment to Mr. Haigh's HSBC Dubai bank account. Now, if I could please invite Your Honour's attention to JP6-308. It's difficult to read.
Yep.
This is a manuscript payment instruction from GFH to their bankers. It's signed by Bijou Matthew and David Haigh. Again, Mr. Haigh disputes whether he put his signature there. But in the middle of the page, does Your Honour see Lincoln Associates written in manuscript?
Yep.
And underneath it is the IBAN number. And the last few digits, 0350486. So that was the account number we saw a moment ago in one of the 42 invoices. JP6312. This one is marginally easier to read because it's typed. Your Honour sees again signed by Bijou Matthew and David Haigh. Again, Mr. Haigh might dispute that he put his signature there. But does Your Honour see full name Lincoln Associates? count number, IGAN number, and now we have zero towards the end of that long number, 090-733-21050. In a moment I'll come to Mr. Haigh's bank accounts, but we can see these payments being received. Next in the audit trail, can I ask Your Honour to turn please to JP6347. This is a very poorly copied retainer letter from GPW. Now the reason I show this to Your Honour is because this is a legitimate document. But Your Honour can see it's signed by Mr. Haigh, but Mr. Haigh has written fake Desiree. Now Desiree Edwards is Mr. Haigh, or was Mr. Haigh's personal assistant.
Well, how do I know that that's his writing?
We know it's his writing. This particular document.
How do I know?
There isn't handwriting evidence about this. One of the reasons we know is because it was appended to a handwriting report prepared by Mr. Radley for Mr. Haigh. We didn't put it there. This wasn't. When we put it there.
This was meant to be a genuine.
This is a genuine.
Used.
Yes.
Which Mr. Radley used.
Mr. Radley says this may be a fake signature. The point is, somebody at least has written fake Desiree.
Yeah.
In other words, it's suggested that even on legitimate documents, Mr. Haigh's signature might have been put there by other people. The question to Your Honour perhaps isn't so much in the modern world where things can be copied and pasted, particularly electronically, which particular individual put any particular mark on a piece of paper. The point is, when one sees it so consistently, as one does, in both legitimate and illegitimate documents, surely Mr. Haigh must have known this was happening, and surely it must have been happening with Mr. Haigh's agreement. And the issue is not, could somebody superimpose Mr. Haigh's signature on a document? The issue is, could somebody superimpose Mr. Haigh's signature on documents, plural, here, there, and everywhere, without Mr. Haigh coming to know about it? And if it's wholly improbable that that could, then in my submission, Your Honour is entitled to conclude Mr. Haigh has no real answer to our case, which is that he created or caused to be created these documents. Mr. Haigh has overlooked the second part of that, or caused to be created. And approved or procured their approval.
It occurred to me that since he has relied in his pleaded defence on the report of Mr. Radley and also, if I remember rightly, the report of PwC,
yes,
that I should look at those and see what they say in his support.
I can take your
answer. So I'll need a reference to those, please.
In fact, the PwC report, I can take Your Honour to, very quickly, because in fact it opens It is JP6 page-551 and following. And Your Honour finds that in volume in bundle 3. And we can consider it, perhaps.
Is that he relies in his defence on this for procedures within
yes.
the claim.
Yes.
So where do I find whatever is important from that point of view?
That's a, well, we say it's missing. They assert in their executive summary, from the review of limited information that could be made available, Mr. Haigh, in his positions at both GFH and Leeds United, would incur business-related expenses on a monthly basis. Advanced payments would be made. Mr. Haigh would generally incur expenses on both the GFH credit card and also personally. He would in most cases retain copies of the receipts to support his business-related expenditure. Mr. Haigh would identify personal expenses. The finance department at GFH would prepare expense claims. Mr. Haigh would rely heavily on the finance team and his PA to keep track of his expenses and advances. We have not seen or identified any documents to demonstrate that prior to 20th January 2014, employee expense claims were authorised by anyone at GFH before payment was made. There was a reconciliation process undertaken by the finance department to monitor the advances. Now, Mr. Haigh, if as a result of the reconciliation process Mr. Haigh had a balance due, he would repay. Mr. Haigh would make repayments to GFH to cover excess advances paid to him. And the accounting system utilised by GFH contains ledger codes for accounts. To account for advances provided to Mr. Haigh. It's essentially that PwC, from his preliminary view of what Mr. Haigh has provided to him, feels that Mr. Haigh is telling the truth. Section 2 is of no relevance whatsoever. 3, it would appear that commissions were due to Mr. Haigh and the lack of access to Mr. Haigh of contemporaneous documents and key individuals limits our ability to provide further analysis of these commissions or the true value, and then asks for multiple disclosure.
Where do we find Appendix A?
Appendix A is at the end of the document. In fairness, I'm not sure that PwC would suggest
no.
that this
no.
is...
It's so qualified, it's pointless.
I fear that...
I'm sorry to be so blunt in Mr. Haigh's absence, but really it's... Right.
I wasn't proposing to say much more about it.
No.
What Your Honour does see, however, is a fair amount of documentation provided to PwC at an early stage when it suited Mr. Haigh's purposes to provide it.
Not much.
But it's not much. The point is it's not documentation which we get. It's not documentation which is in the evidence. So, for example, his monthly credit card statements, his checkbook stubs, the bank statements for a NatWest account, Mr. Haigh's employment contract came later, transcripts from WhatsApp messenger services provided by Mr. Haigh.
Now, what about the Radley report?
The Radley report, I think, is just before. Yes, it is. It is. Maybe the only two of us. But the Radley report, I should tell you, Sean, relates only to whether or not Mr. Haigh's signature is Mr. Haigh's signature or is superimposed. That's it. That's the evidence. And he concludes that in the majority of cases it's been superimposed. There is an issue with the Radley report that was exhibited to the defence, which Sir David Steele referred to, 24th of March, when the matter is going to Mr. Haigh's credibility, which is that when Mr. Haigh launched his private prosecution, he served a subsequent report from Mr. Radley, after Mr. Radley had inspected original documents, which concluded in, I think, five instances, Mr. Haigh's pen-on-ink signature, and his own handwriting expert said it was his pen-on-ink signature, was on 14 documents. Now, we don't put handwriting evidence and the signature itself front and centre of our case. The point to be made about the fact of Mr. Haigh's name being on every single document in the 14th audit trail is, if somebody looked at this, who were they going to ask about?
Sort of an elephant in the room here, though. If he didn't put his signature on,
well,
did someone else? Who did and why?
Well, that's why I
took it with him. Did they get a rake off, or was it a genuine false audit trail, if there can be such a thing?
Your Honour's proved to me, did Mr. Haigh have help? And the answer is he may well have done. Now, whether that help was witting or unwitting, we can't say. We haven't joined any other person within GFH as a defendant to this claim. Your Honour is, of course, not an investigating tribunal to identify the perpetrators. But that was one reason why I took Your Honour to the GPW retainer letter with Mr. Haigh's signature on it, which somebody had written fake Desiree. In other words, it's asserted that's a fake signature on a legitimate document.
That's a pretty weak little item. It might give you a foundation for a speculation, but
now,
why any more?
Well, firstly, the defence doesn't really, there are a number of elephants in various parts of the room, I fear. First, well, Mr. Haigh must have had quite some help from inside. Now, that may be so. We don't say to the contrary. What we say is that doesn't make him any less liable. The fact that others may also be liable doesn't make
this, it may not be right to immediately leap to saying had help. He says that there was a practice of creating false invoices. That is not help to him in a nefarious plan. That's something different.
Yes. Now, what is, as I understand that defense, that line of defense, it is that Mr. Haigh is aware that there were practices in other contexts of creating false documents. And the suggestion in the defense is that those documents would be created to mask payments out that GFH should not have been making, or to mask the source of funds. Of course, GFH denies that wrongdoing, and I put that on the record once again. But it's completely irrelevant to this case. Because that particular elephant in my submission is asleep. It's a horrible, I've now made it into a horrible metaphor. But for this reason, whatever may have happened in other contexts, Mr. Haigh's case is that these payments were not payments that GFH shouldn't have been making.
Yes.
So that argument, that analysis simply went wrong.
I follow that. But what does that leave as the preferred explanation?
Well,
if the signatures were creations, not by him.
Well, there is a schedule prepared, in fact, by me, which I was going to come to later. In fact, can I come to it later?
Right.
Which analyzes Professor Radley's report, the original report. And it's not that somebody has sat at a piece of paper and carefully forged signatures. What he identifies is that there were a number of examples of Mr. Haigh's signature which were imposed upon these documents.
Imposed by a photocopying process?
For example, yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And in fact, when one analyzes through, one sees that Professor Radley can only show the same signature being used consecutively in two documents, or two or three instances. There are 25 different versions of this signature. Now, we don't know whether somebody helped Mr. Haigh knowingly and received something in return. We don't know whether somebody who's helping say unwittingly with a practice of simply putting signatures on documents if the person who would otherwise be needed to sign them was away from the office. We don't know whether Mr. Haigh himself created various documents carefully in order giving himself plausible deniability letters. The point isn't the handwriting evidence. It would be a wonderful thing if I could take Your Honour to our own expert who has said, I've examined the originals and every one of them is signed pen on ink by Mr. Haigh's hand. Because then I'm not sure that this application would take very long at all. Then combine it with the fact of the receipt. That we can't show. So in that respect, it is a little bit like a more traditional false invoicing fraud. But every one of these documents, I've taken you on as the example of Lincoln Associates. The same is true of GPW. The same is true of the Fountain Court payment instructions. Somebody would have asked Mr. Haigh, What is all this? And if Mr. Haigh was not the author of this scheme, whoever was manufacturing this audit trail was taking an extraordinary risk. Because if anybody did ask, he would be the one they would ask. And his response would be, I've never seen these documents before. But as Your Honour saw, before the short adjournment, GFH was audited. And indeed, one of the invoices that Mr. Haigh failed to provide was asked for from Gibson Dunn. And Gibson Dunn asked him, and he produced it. So that shows that is exactly how one might have expected every year to have been undertaken. And if that's right, then it is absolutely inevitable that this would have been brought to Mr. Haigh's attention. Because Mr. Haigh is the only person you can ask.
He hadn't signed whatever was necessary to cause them to occur. He must have known that someone else had.
Yes.
And he must therefore have condoned any reproduction of his signature. And therefore, on your case, caused it.
Yes. Yes. Now, of course, he says he wasn't remotely surprised to be receiving all these large sums of money from multiple bank accounts because they were all owed him.
Yes, but he should still have asked himself how they got there.
Right. Yes. Yes. Now, of course, in fairness to Mr. Haigh, he may say, although he doesn't, that he would not expect to approve and instruct payments to himself. Obvious reasons. This case may be a prime example of why people aren't allowed to generally. Now, he doesn't actually say that, and one of the difficulties in this case is one can be left with the sense of an elephant in the room, but which one can't quite identify. And one then starts trying to get at what Mr. Haigh may wish to say, while he absents himself and chooses not to say.
Well, what all this is going to is that part of the principle of summary judgment applications about whether or not a more detailed investigation should be allowed, which will clarify
quite
things which are not clear.
Quite. And in our submission, there is, firstly, this isn't a case where there is a defence which appears to need more investigation. Mr. Haigh's case on the handwriting aspect, on the creation, the process of creating the documents, is non est factum. So one wouldn't expect him to be able to assist the court with more detailed information on something which he says he had no part of. But what one would have expected him to be able to do, if it be the case that he had reached agreement with the claimant, that he would be receiving millions of dirhams and millions of pounds. That he would have some note of that agreement, even if only to protect himself.
Well, in relation to, we have three matters, effectively, which he says entitled him to money.
Yes.
One was reimbursement of expenses.
Yes.
Second was salary, if I remember rightly, and the third was Leeds United.
The commission agreement, yes.
Oh, commission agreements, of course, I'm sorry. Four, am I right?
The Leeds United was, perhaps if I summarise the Leeds United position, GFH owned Leeds United at this time, and it put Mr. Haigh in post there. Originally as a non-executive director, latterly as managing director. His payment was in about 500 Bahraini dinar per day, plus expenses. We know that because there's a letter, and it was to be paid by Leeds United, not by GFH Capital, as is to be expected. Leeds United had financial issues. Also, fairly quickly, Mr. Haigh started to entertain ambitions of buying Leeds United from the claimant. And he suggested that he was in a position to lend what was a total of £1.775 million to Leeds United, short term, to assist it with its financing requirements. And so he did so in a sequence of payments, which were then repaid by Leeds United. The first part of that, payment of $600,000, was repaid through the new owner of Leeds United and his private office, the consulting firm that manages it. And that money was in turn used towards the purchase of real estate in the United Kingdom. The second substantial tranche was not immediately repaid by Leeds United. And Mr. Haigh, through his company, Sport Capital, Guernsey, issued a winding up petition against Leeds United, which Leeds United failed to have set aside. And so the owner of Leeds United again paid that back. He paid it back to his solicitors who were acting for Sport Capital in the United Kingdom. And that was the point at which we got our freezing. And so the funds in the guy's client account, that you're going to see reference to, are the repayments of the loan by Leeds United, which was actually made by Mr. Cellino, nominally to Sport Capital Limited, which has sat in Guy's solicitors and is now in the client account of a solicitor in Guernsey, Guy's solicitors. We say, however, that once we had the bank accounts, you could see very clearly he lent to Leeds United our money. Much of it, in fact, the Fountain Court invoices.
Yeah, but as to that, I would need to check it again, but does he not say that the money which he obtained from Fountain was a kind of salary for his office?
He says it was, yes, he says it was salary and expenses,
yes,
for his time in Leeds United.
So we have, he says he was entitled to the money that he got as expenses, as commission, as salary,
yes,
and as Leeds United salary.
Yes.
Salary and expenses.
That's what he says. All supported by a fraudulent audit trail suggesting that the money was in fact going to four legitimate third parties. And there again, would a more detailed investigation expose that a tissue thin case that looks good on paper? Well, lightning may strike once. But from the same bolt of lightning effectively to strike, in the same place, in respect of four different suppliers of professional services, and in respect of a total of five different bank accounts, is simply impossible. Submission, whether it is possible to precisely identify an invoice, a corresponding payment instruction, and a receipt in the records, this was a deliberate scheme by somebody. And it was a deliberate scheme placed money in the hands of Mr. Haigh with the appearance that it was going to multiple recipients who had a good reason to receive it. Well, and that's why we come back to the preponderance of probability.
Yeah, but on one view that is consistent with his case. He says, yes, there was a deliberate scheme. It was to put money in my pocket. But, he says, I was entitled to the money.
Yes. And there, and that is why that was the second reason I took Your Honour to re-age, to remind Your Honour of that dictum. In one sense, it is, of course, authority for the blind and the obvious in today's world, so well established. But it is sometimes overlooked that what Brooke Nichols is saying is that when looking at what is more likely than not, some things are inherently more likely than others. And it is inherently more likely that when so many different suppliers end up with so many different fraudulent invoices, all requesting payment to the same person, the emails asking for payments come from that same person. The only third party who received any funds supported by fraudulent instruction is a close friend of that person. And all the payment instructions have that person's signature. And every fraudulent invoice approved is approved in the name of that person. I say it's inherently more likely that that person is the author of the scheme.
Now, what weight, if any, can I place on the fact that he has not come to this application with some evidence to support his entitlement to expenses, etc.?
Yes. On one view, it's tempting to say he hasn't filed any evidence and he hasn't attempted, so this application is unresisted. But I know that's not an argument.
You've still got to make out your case. Quite. You can't use the language of unresisted.
We don't rely just on Mr. Haigh's absence and the absence of any evidence today. We rely on the fact that we made £200,000 available to him in September of 2014. And all of the various matters I took Your Honour to this morning to show that the absence of any evidence to support his defence, or any meaningful evidence, has to be seen in the context that it has failed to materialise over the course of 2 years now. When we undoubtedly have the resources to provide it if it is there.
Well, one of the factors I can take into account is the likely evidence that there might be at a trial.
Yes.
Now, at a very simple level, you are able to submit that because there hasn't been a sniff of evidence today, I can conclude more comfortably that it's unlikely that there'll be any evidence at a trial.
Absolutely. And we say that, but we go further. It is not just that there's no evidence today. There hasn't been any evidence for 2 years, notwithstanding the battery of professional advisors who seem to have run an extraordinary costs.
Oh, today is the culmination of the 2 years.
Exactly. That's in our submission, that is what removes any possible doubt about what Mr. Haigh may be able to prove at trial, what may come to life. It's not just a question of some analysis of documents we've provided. Somebody has gone through a lot of detailed records. Mr. Haigh has put in evidence, as appended to the PwC report, an internal review within GFH. Which, by the way, recorded. This is all in Mr. Kell's witness statement, which, by the way, recorded. That the control of expenses at Leeds United would be placed in the hands of Mr. Haigh. So, Your Honour, we say the evidence is very strong. Now, hopefully, at the front of Volume 6, hopefully Your Honour has some Excel spreadsheets. We haven't done the exercise of Mr. Ritiyama's NatWest bank account because there are only 3 pages. But we have done it with his 2 HSBC accounts and with the two cooperative accounts. And the way these schedules work is as follows, because it's not every single payment. But hopefully, Your Honour starts to get a picture that we've done the audit trail. Correlating payments and evidence. And on the right hand side of the schedules is the destinations.
Well, take me through one. Dewey and LeBerf doesn't seem to feature.
Dewey and LeBerf are interesting. They're not part of the claim because we discovered it after the amendment and because we didn't really want to add yet another supplier. Particularly one which was now bankrupt, with the difficulties of evidence that would come, and particularly given that there are a number of allegations. But Your Honour knows who Julian and Murph were. And Your Honour sees 3 payments received.
I don't know quite why I should be looking at Julian and Murph. Why don't we go to Lincoln Associates?
No, the only reason for that is Mr. Haigh makes much of expenses reconciliations. And he exhibits a cheque stub, driving term for 20,000 dirhams, in early 2013 to show he was making payments to GFH. And certainly he was. But then we discovered these 3 fraudulent Dewey and LeBerf invoices, and the payments to his bank account on the strength of them, which he then used to make, at least in part, the receipts on the right hand side, to make a payment to the claimant. For Lincoln Associates, I'm going to have to use my phone, I am afraid, because my eyes simply aren't good enough. Lincoln Associates invoice. I am trying, yes. Your Honor sees 1, 2, 3, 4 up from the bottom. On the left hand side is the paragraph in D. Next to the thick line is the payment into his bank account.
Well, let's just take one. If I go to the paragraph crawl of a particular claim, you get the first one then. 53,600. This is a false invoice, or allegedly
yes.
False invoice. 53,600.
Yes.
Okay, now I see that amount in the very first Lincoln Associates reference on the spreadsheet. Doesn't have paragraph 12.1 next to it. Is this a way that I should be starting to understand this?
The difficulty is that first Lincoln Associates entry, the very first Lincoln Associates entry is the first after a number of narrow lines.
Yes.
And it has paragraph NA with two invoices that we were able to identify but which aren't.
Well,
because they came too late.
Paragraph 12.1 of the particulars of claim alleges a false invoice for 53,600 dirham.
Yes.
That seems to be the very, very first Lincoln Associates entry.
Well, that's the there's an invoice. 53,600.
Yeah. So you've got.
But there's two invoices in this payment. In that thick line, there's two invoices in that payment.
So we follow that through to a payment reference.
Yes.
Which.
Fund transfer forms.
Payment transfer form amount 149,600 dirham.
Yes.
So what this tells me is that there was a funds transfer form which instructed payment of 149,600 dirham, and that was a transfer
now,
in purported satisfaction of two invoices, one for the 53,600 dirham and the other for 96,000 dirham.
And then as we go through...
Hang on. Is the 96,000 dirham one of the allegedly false invoices? There is a 30th of May 2001 in that account.
Yes.
In that amount, rather, which looks like
yes.
The ref the narration.
And then, Your Honour.
So, just let me try and work through it. So, what this reconciliation is meant to tell me is that those two false invoices were paid by the one payment.
Yes. Yes. sorry, that one here, yes. But then one goes further, because closer to this, the line, the thick line in the middle, there is the narrative that appears on the face of the bank statement. we have the statements for this account. So it records GFH Capital professional fees as the reason for the payment. Your Honour mentioned a moment ago.
I'm sorry, I don't think I followed that. Just check it out again. I see those references.
Yes, that's the narrative that one sees in the face of the bank statements. So
that's of the actual account itself?
Yes, of the actual account itself.
Well, how would that have got there?
Because that's the payment reference which GFH Capital put in. In fact, if one looks at the payment instructions, they
on GFH's bank statement?
No, Mr. Haigh's. So you're on those very often in the bank, that when you make a transfer, you will make a...
Ah, yes. This was by a direct debit transfer, wasn't it?
Yes, they were inter-account transfers, yes.
Yeah, right.
Yes. So that's the reference that was given by GFH to this transfer. Mm-hmm. And that's when it's appeared on Mr. Haigh's bank statement. Now, Your Honour raised a moment ago, Mr. Haigh being aware of receiving the money. He wasn't just receiving large amounts of money. He was receiving it for professional... misdescribed as professional fees. And so one sees the account and the evidence. We've also tracked the money out. And what you already see is most of the money left for the United Kingdom. We know this because there's a very much easier document to read. Another A3 schedule called a Haigh HSBC UK account.
I'm sorry, I'm just checking through. Those, the amounts in those two invoices that we've been talking about, according to Mr. Haigh's defence, were payments for expenses.
And they're accounted for as professional fees.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm sorry, you're going to go...
And so there is another schedule, much easier to read, which is headed Haigh HSBC UK account. This one, for some reason, has been printed half and half. But Your Honour sees.
Not until you tell me where I look for it.
It's the same section.
Oh, the same one.
Tab 6.
Sorry.
All the A3 schedules for the income tab 6.
Oh, no. The one I have is HSBC Dubai.
Yes. After that, there should be co-op.
After that, there's co-op, yes.
And then after that, there should be HSBC UK.
Thank you. I'm with you.
And so, I'll come to the co-op in a moment. But does Europe sees repeatedly global transfer?
Yeah.
Now, global transfer is HSBC code for an account between HSBC accounts of cross-border. And so what one finds is that Mr. Haigh received essentially all of the money that came in from us, supported by fraudulent invoices, into his HSBC UK account.
Again, you see, what I'm trying to do is to relate these to the pleaded case.
whom feeded it. We end on this. This shows you on where the money went to, so it's more a piece of evidence.
Indeed, but where...
The pleaded case is all on the left-hand side of each of the HSBC to buy and co-op share.
Okay, true. Now, just take the first one, AD 300,000. Which one is this? Is this a GPW or what?
First entry of
the first entry on the Haigh HSBC UK account page.
The first entry on the Haigh HSBC due date for 300,000 is the 20th of August of 2013. So the date would be the 20th of August of 2013, which can we find it? Constructing solicitor's eyes are much better than mine. But essentially, it's the payment out on the 20th of August of 2013.
No.
Comes out in dirhams and in sterling, 300,000, 20th of August.
Yeah.
So on the second page, yes, but could my instructor system read it? Because he can read the tiny script. I've got it electronically, but that's on the second page.
It's the top entrance, you're on the top entry in the second page. At the left, it's... Where should I start?
We're going to take it to 300,000.
Yeah. In the last section, to the right of the grey line, there's a section that says 300,000 dirhams. 28th of August 2013, the currency AED, Emirati dirhams. Then it says global transfer, capital G, capital P, capital E, capital J, capital P, capital G, capital V, capital X, number 3, capital Y, and then a blank column. And the column to the right is pound sign 51,431. Corresponding receipt in HSBC same reference.
Yes. And so, and you're on C's. The payment is in prior to.
No, we must be at cross purposes. I don't know what this is meant to be showing me, but what I thought you were going to show me was that this identified
yes.
A false invoice
no.
Number
no.
Or pleaded as number so and so and the payment of that invoice.
Oh no, that is in the HSBC UK account.
Right, well then
put that aside for that.
Then what is this telling me?
What this tells you, Your Honour, is where the money went to. In other words, what Mr. Haigh says is the payment of salary expenses and commissions almost entirely goes to the United Kingdom.
Well, what's wrong with that if in fact it wasn't?
Well, for a start, you wouldn't expect the money to be available if it's in the reimbursement expenses.
Why not?
Because you'd already spent it. There's no source of... There's no... What Your Honour doesn't see in the HSBC Dubai account is another substantial source of income, which is going out again.
I'm sorry, being obtuse because I just don't see what this.
I fear I might have jumped forward. Perhaps I would assist more if I were to focus for the moment on the pleaded case.
Yes, good start.
And because the pleaded case ends with Mr. Haigh's receipt of the money.
Now, I thought that we were getting to something that was touched on this morning, namely relating the false invoice amounts with the payment amounts.
Yes.
Which we did a moment ago with two invoices.
Yes. And what the left-hand side of the HSBC Dubai schedule does is the same exercise
for each one.
For each one.
Now, with what success? Complete success?
It's not 100%, but it's, we say, close enough. It's near enough 100% success. In other words, what happened, I can tell you, right, the way that things unlocked, as one might often imagine, was from the bank statements. It's often said, follow the money. Well, in this case, one could follow the audit trail. Because when we could see the receipt of the money into the bank account, it was possible to identify, from looking at our bank statement, the money out, and from that, identify the payment instruction. And from that, one would have the audit records, which would then identify the relevant invoice.
But the one, in an ideal world, one would have an invoice which you say is a false invoice,
yes,
purportedly
from Lincoln Associates
for 300,000 dirham.
Yes.
And you would then have a payment instruction.
Yes.
Please pay 300,000
yes.
to this
yes.
bank account, which happens to be a Haigh bank account, for 300,000. And then you would have a bank statement which shows 300,000
yes.
going to that account.
Exactly.
Now, then there may be a doubling up, as we saw a moment ago.
Yes.
But one, in theory, would be able to
reconcile it. We have been able to reconcile pleaded invoices with the receipts. What we found was some more fraudulent payments which aren't in the pleadings.
Yeah, well,
which
that's
a different matter.
Okay. Well, I'm,
it is
one
not different.
I'm not concerned with them, but I am concerned.
Yes.
To see, if I can, that the received amounts can be related to the false invoices. Because if they can't, do I start to wonder, is there some other explanation for all this
right.
which should be investigated at a trial? Now, that's
the
offer.
That's the concern. Well, Your Honour, the first thing is that it's not the way the case is put for the defendant. And it is a case of what is the likely evidence at the trial based on the pleadings, not what might a defendant be able to say if given free rein to hypothesize. But the second thing, we have been able to reconcile receipts by Mr. Haigh to the invoices. On occasions there's doubling up, on occasions the invoices are split. What is not possible is to say, for example, on the 1st of April is an invoice which was introduced into the auditing system, into the records of the claimant on the 2nd of April, which was then authorised for payment on the 10th of April, with the payment instruction on the 12th of April and a receipt, say on the 13th of April, which would be the ideal scenario. But in exactly the same way that if I were able to present a handwriting expert to say Mr. Haigh put his pen on ink signature on every one of these documents, this application would be very short. I anticipate that if I was able to do that, this application would again be very short. What he has done is created invoices where the dates don't necessarily correlate with the date of the payment at all. And that was one of the reasons for the difference.
Well, does that amount to a submission that the invoices may have been created long after the payment?
Well, some of the invoices predate on their face the payment by many months.
Yes.
Yeah, you remember, I showed you on the middle-aged one.
I thought I noted that some appeared to post-date it by...
And some did once, and sometimes they have been introduced after the event. And that was why I took Your Honour through the emails to the solicitors, because it's the clearest possible example.
That was one example. But the payment instructions
They must precede the payment
all
in each
precede
case.
The payment.
And so, as Fiona goes through that schedule, you're on the seas. That we have absolutely no difficulty with. We can identify the payment instruction. And it may be that there is the odd piece of paper that's missing as pieces of paper go, but we can identify the payment instruction. And it was from that that we were then able to do the backward exercise. As Fiona might imagine, before we had the bank statements and we were able to do these reconciliations, there's a rather confusing picture where logically one would think that you're on a positive. Invoice, approval, authorization, instruction, receipt. And so one has pleadings which list the invoices in date order. And one has receipt, one has payments which make list the payments in date order. But they don't necessarily correlate because the invoices don't necessarily correlate on date. But then the invoices were really created to justify the payment. Now whether they were created beforehand as part of an orchestrated scheme, or they were created just after. We don't know for sure. What we can say is this, and Your Honor highlighted, there is this very curious invoice, GPW invoice, which is false, but gives correct payment, gives correct bank accounts for GPW, and actually pays for legitimate invoices from GPW. When one looks at the co-op schedule, that's the David Murray, effectively, payments, the Fountain Court payments. There are a number of Fountain Court FINAs that we found that were never paid. And what, again, one should be careful about hypothesizing and speculating, but what may have happened, if one is looking for a likely explanation, is that there were so many of these documents being created for so many different scenarios, that Mr. Haigh occasionally lost control of which ones had been paid, which ones had been introduced, which ones hadn't been introduced. That is what we would submit is the most likely explanation for the confused audit trail. But that it is a fraudulent audit trail is not disputed.
Well, from one point of view, an invoice created afterwards, apparently corresponding to an earlier payment, supports your case, because if there had been a practice of false invoicing within the company, surely they would have done their false invoicing at the time of payment.
Well, that's another way of looking at it. And of course the difficulty is this, one ends up having to speculate about the probabilities of a possibility of a hypothetical. And the reality is this, all of the documents have Mr. Haigh's name on them, all of the documents ask for a payment to his bank account, and the money went to his bank account. Now, he doesn't say in his defense, this claim has been cooked up after the event, that it's a fraudulent claim. You understand what I mean? His defence doesn't say that.
No, I don't. What do you mean?
What I mean is, one of the things that he's floated in the UK criminal proceedings that hasn't pleaded in.
The GFH cooked up before.
Yes, the GFH have cooked this entire claim up after the event and manufactured all of this evidence so that this is all one big conspiracy to further the course of justice. He doesn't actually plead that as his defence anyway. It may be that those who pleaded it for him knew better about the consequences. So, really one is asked, one is forced to ask, what is the most likely explanation for the creation of this fraudulent audit trail? Now, one then considers the use to which the money was put. That use is set out by Mr. Patel. His witness statement. Again, it's not as easy as money into HSBC, 300,000 dirhams into HSBC UK, 50,000 pounds out to Changi's solicitors for property. Somebody appears to have told him what he remembered from his law books, the law days, the mingling of trust property and tracing and follow. I don't think he anticipated the judgment in the Federal Republic of Brazil case. What we have done, what Mr. Patel does in his witness statement, which we already see, we take one transaction and follow through the movement of money backwards and forwards. But for the rest of it, in these schedules, and the way these schedules have been created, we strip that out. So if money moves from HSBC account number one to HSBC account number two, to the co-op, to HSBC UK, the schedule will simply say HSBC account, HSBC Dubai account one, HSBC UK. So it's what the what Lord Tilson described as its substance, the transaction, to prevent that precise money laundering, cross-firing money backwards and forwards.
How does this help in deciding whether or not your case is a summary judgment case? Because if the money was his,
he's free to behave with it as he pleases.
He could do what he liked, exactly. And then it seems to be perhaps a very long bow to say, well, if he then moved it half a dozen times in and out of accounts, that must have been in order to avoid a tracing exercise and therefore something or other.
Well, that's exactly the point.
As I say, it seems a long bow.
Well, in our submission, it's not a long bow. You see, if this is your money, and one is extended, if I receive a very large amount of money, which I am expecting, and I have a use which I intend to make of that money, to buy a property, to make a football team, one would expect that I would do that in the most efficient manner. What one would not expect is payment to multiple bank accounts, which are then collected and then paid out again and then collected, or which are cross-fired between accounts in the couple of days before the payment out. Because it's simply unnecessary, and the only reason for doing it is to confuse the audit trail. And the only reason one confuses the audit trail once the money is received is to make it harder to follow, we say. But this is a piece of evidence. It's one of the pieces of evidence. Perhaps, Your Honour, so far as the defence is concerned, I can assist most by going to section C of Mr. Patel's witness statement, third witness statement. It's page 18. I can go to the documents referred to if I'm asked to, but I wasn't proposing to at this stage. Yet it should be divided into bundle 5. Bundle 1, tab 8. If one turns to page 18, top of the page, the evolution of the defense. So the first thing he did was announce to the world that the authorities will see clearly the motives which lie behind these allegations. On the 3rd of June, the Mr. Haigh was represented. It was an ex parte on notice application. It was said that there had been a 1-hour conference with him, and then presumably on instructions, it is said, on his behalf. There's no evidence to support the contention that Mr. Haigh held any of the accounts into which fraudulent payments were made, and GFH Capital had failed to establish that the fraudulent payments had even left their own bank account, much less being paid into the relevant bank accounts. Now, the case had been served at this point. Particulars of claim had been served. So Mr. Haigh's first answer was, "I know nothing about any of this. You haven't even proved you made the payments." On the 9th of June of 2014, Mr. Patel received a call from a journalist seeking a comment on a press release issued on behalf of Mr. Haigh, which said that having reviewed the documents, his signatures may be forgeries, and that others had access to his emails. So this is the embryo of his pleaded case. And inferentially, the senior people within GFH must have had knowledge of the transaction. On the 15th of June, Mr. Haigh's then solicitors said it was impossible for him to plead to each and every allegation contained in the particulars of claim. But that what had been said in his press release was no more than what could have been gleaned by someone sitting in the courtroom during the hearing. On the 4th of August, Stevenson Harwood wrote, and the page references are there, wrote that their client had maintained a consistent position throughout. He does not recognize the fake invoices, is not aware of them, and had no part whatever in creating them. And that was the first handwriting. Then, claimants then solicitors asked Mr. Haigh to confirm whether he owned bank accounts. Well, the response was to say the court shouldn't even engage with that question until it had resolved the handwriting issues. The 11th of August, so a week later, Stevenson Harwood, presumably on instructions, said that our client maintains his position that he cannot recall whether he controlled the purported bank accounts. That was a line taken in front of John Chadwick on the 17th of June. However, the letter went on to confirm that Mr. Haigh did hold accounts with HSBC and the co-op. The details of which he could not recollect, but that as far as our client can recollect, he does not have an account with NatWest. That's the Milnet payments, three very specific Milnet payments. 22nd of August, once the co-op discloses material, Stevenson Harwood wrote that Mr. Haigh had made it abundantly clear that he is willing to repay any amounts that may have inadvertently and or mistakenly been diverted to accounts which are purported to belong to him. And he hadn't in fact made such an offer, but the Honour may think it's telling that Mr. Haigh's first reaction to the knowledge that his banks were about to disclose or had disclosed his bank accounts was to suggest he was more than willing to repay anything that may have inadvertently found its way into his accounts. So on the 3rd of September, a news report appeared on ArabianBusiness.com that next week Mr. Haigh would present a report from PwC, and that it was a report which would 100% exonerate him. That's the report from PwC that Giona has looked at. Then there was an application filed on the 4th of September. Uh, one of the premises of the report from PwC, the original report, was that no evidence had been provided to link Mr. Haigh to the fraudulent bank accounts. They're his accounts. That preliminary report was dated the 19th of August. Of course, by the 4th of September, we at least had some of the bank accounts. So we knew at least a couple of accounts to be Mr. Haigh's, but PwC were not asked to address that. So also on the 4th of September, Mr. Haigh acknowledged that he owned the co-op accounts for the first time. He could neither confirm nor deny sending emails in October and November, but otherwise he was silent about email instructions. He appeared to accept that it's possible that he instructed Mr. Matthew to conceal the amount and purpose of at least the payments instructed in the eve of the 21st of November. Haigh asserted that withdrawals from the co-op accounts were intended to protect my funds from the difficulties being encountered by co-op. Now that's quite significant given that it comes on the 4th of September, after two hearings and miscellaneous letters and an expert's report, so-called, where none of which recalled Mr. Haigh is saying, of course I remember, of course I got payments into a co-op account, I own a co-op, of course I hold a co-op account. It received just over £1 million, which was my salary from Leeds United. He, no doubt in a slip of the tongue, says, I transferred £57,000 to the NatWest account. That's Mr. Etiana's account. And Mr. Haigh appeared to assert that he received payment of expenses, but that without having access to such information related to any other bank account, it is difficult for me to ascertain or confirm whether monies were received into my accounts. Eight plus million dirhams in salary and expenses. But without seeing the bank statements, I really don't know. The only other defence put forward at that time was the general allegation that this whole thing would be brought about in some way to conceal impropriety on the part of GFH Capital. Then there was further evidence in advance of the 15th September hearing. Contrary to all that had gone before, Haigh's true defence would be set out in a further witness statement in support of a different application to be made the following week. In fact, Mr. Haigh made two applications which are heard on the 15th of September, and we made one of our own. The one we made was for a letter of request. It was not controversial, and the order was met. Mr. Haigh, aside from the freezing order variation, which I took Your Honour to this morning, made an application for disclosure of what amounted to GFH's business records for the last 2 years, or for the previous 2 years. It was suggested that as part of that disclosure application, there would be an indication of the defence. Now, that didn't materialise, but at the hearing on the 15th of September, Mr. Haigh's leading counsel told the court, and he said, I am able to indicate on instruction that the summary of the defendant's position is this: that the fake invoices were not created or procured by the defendant. They were created by others of the claimant for its purposes, and it was part of the normal modus operandi of the claimant's Dubai office, to use invoices of this nature, that the payments made to accounts of the defendant pursuant to this scheme were intended by the claimant to be used by the defendant in furtherance of GFH's commitments, obligations, and business generally, and in relation to the defendant, and that this was done with a reconciliation as between the claimant and the defendant being done periodically. Thirdly, that the use to which the monies were put by the defendant from such accounts as were under his control was to make payments on this basis. So that was the defence on the 15th of September. To summarise, in fact, GFH would simply deposit funds into his accounts for GFH's purposes and to reimburse him. And it would be used for GFH, in furtherance of GFH's commitments, obligations, and business generally, and in relation to him. And then the defence itself arises on the 21st of December of 2014. And Your Honour has seen it. So Your Honour is entitled to conclude, to ask, does Mr. Haigh have any real prospect of establishing his defence? When one considers how long it took and how many attempts he made to settle on it. His own counsel on the 15th of September had to admit that there was some force in the submission, and that his position had not been consistent in correspondence. In particular, Your Honour is entitled to ask, what would a trial judge make of a defendant who says, this is an outrage, I have no part in this fraudulent audit trail, everything was totally legitimate, and there were good reasons for my receipt of millions of dirhams and millions of pounds. Who takes nearly 8 months to say it. And whose first reaction is, accounts? What accounts? I'm not even sure I hold an account. We say, when combined with the sophistication of the fraudulent audit trail, that carefully identifies bank accounts, particularly one of the Lincoln Associates, same is true of GPW, same is true of Milnet insofar as there was an invoice. Fountain Court, the Finos didn't have the account, but there are payment instructions consistently. The thing about the Fountain Court fee notes is that they are very good. Perhaps I should take Your Honour to one.
We'll do that, but when we get to Fountain Court, it seems to me that it would be interesting to investigate his explanation for those amounts, namely, was on what basis could he have been entitled to that money in relation to his services to the football club?
Yes. Can I take Your Honour to Mr. Haigh's employment contract with, well, same point of contract, letter of engagement with Leeds United. Although in fairness to Mr. Haigh, before I do that, I should take Your Honour, please, to bundle 3. Page 6-550. Your Honour sees that this letter is really not worth the paper it's written on because it's signed by Mr. Haigh's PA, notwithstanding the way that she describes herself. But it's dated the 7th of October of 2013. And it says, Mr. Haigh's salary, bonus and stock option package from his roles within our group, including Leeds United Football Club, is in excess of £750,000 per year. Now, one can see from the narrative on Mr. Haigh's HSBC accounts, payments of salary, and Mr. Patel deals with his actual salary. But just the Fountain Court invoice, are over £1 million. We'll dig that one out.
Sorry, which one?
The letter from Leeds United to Mr. Haigh that sets out his employment.
But now, what is your position on that, though? I have a general understanding that you say that from that letter he is not entitled to any payment at all from the claimant.
No.
Whatever his entitlement is minuscule.
Certainly by comparison to the amounts.
And cannot justify £1 million.
Yes.
Now, is that broadly it?
I'm sorry?
Is that broadly it, what you say about that?
Yes. Now, Your Honour, do we need to say much more?
I'd like to see the letter.
Sorry?
I'd like to see the letter.
They're just going to turn it up.
But the end result of what you say is that explanation that he gives in his defence simply cannot be correct. Then that reflects, of course, on various other things that he says.
Well, of course. The difficulty, of course, is not just the £1,054,000 to Mr. Haigh from the Fountain Court invoices, Felix. There is also the 8+ million dirhams from Lincoln Associates, much of which is also salary and expenses. So Mr. Haigh's package, if that was what it was in the millions, plural.
Now, what about commission entitlements?
Now,
I really don't have any understanding of that at the moment.
Yes. The commission entitlements arise out of an agreement which was purportedly entered into between a company named Seven Dash Limited and plaintiff. And the terms of that agreement the terms of that agreement were that Mr. Haigh would receive commissions in return for introducing various opportunities and investors into Leeds United Football Club. Now, the...
So do I... Implicit in that is that any question of commission was only in relation to Leeds United Football Club and no question of commissions in relation to activities otherwise on behalf of the claimant?
Well, that seems to be the nature of the claim. Now, Mr. Haigh may well wish to evolve that defence a little more in due course and say that when he said Leeds United, he actually meant anything to do with GFH. But the difficulty is, we say, that Mr. Haigh simply doesn't get off the ground with that agreement because he can't produce one. He can produce a document which purports to be an agreement, but he can't actually produce the agreement.
Well, where do I see whatever he produces?
Now, that's what I've been trying to turn up. Mr. Patel deals with this towards the end of his witness statement. Page 65 to 66. Yes, paragraph page 56, Mr. Haigh deals with. Yes, 755 is the schedule of alleged commission entitlements. This was appended to the PwC report.
Well, wait a minute. Where are we at?
Page 7, GP6-755.
Let's try and keep things in order.
Which is volume 3.
Have we found the engagement with the football club letter yet?
Yes.
Well, the contract.
Yes. But I'm seeing the time here already. I may well go back tomorrow morning. We'll dig. It's quite embarrassing. I highlighted the letter.
I think I would like to understand this, so maybe we'll leave it, but we could go on a bit longer this afternoon if you're
able
to.
But the schedule of commissions, the Honourable find, this is what Mr. Haigh relies on. Turn up the actual 7-dash contract. But the thing is, the contract that was appended to the defence isn't signed.
Well,
And Mr. Haigh has yet to produce one that's signed by anybody from the claimant.
Let's just take things step by step. If we move on from the question of the engagement for the Liverpool Football Club, we are then on to his entitlement or his alleged agreement to, which entitles him to commissions.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, you say that he can't produce a signed agreement. Well, that's fine, but does Mr. Patel say no such agreement was ever signed?
Oh, yes, it's paragraph 153 and following. Mr. Haigh has raised the issue of the purported set off and counterclaim, set out 65. As to that, the following points can be made. Haigh alleges a total of 2.9 million dirhams and 480,000 pounds of payment due to the purported commission agreement.
Please.
Yes.
I want to know whether Patel says no such agreement was ever signed.
Yes.
Doesn't, because if you look at page 154, he refers to a document of at best highly questionable provenance.
Yes.
He also says something about contradiction by some other document. I don't know what that is.
Right.
It's not very palatable to have someone on a summary judgment application say that the defendant has not been able to produce a document which he says we signed.
Yes.
Is it?
Your Honour has in mind that that's a very carefully worded way of saying there may be such a document in existence, but he's not been able to produce it.
Yes.
the whole tenor of paragraph 153 and 154 is that this allegation is not to be believed.
That's different from evidence saying that the claimant never entered into any such agreement.
Well, that's what's in the pleadings, in any event, which is signed by statement of truth. And I can make that good by going to the pleadings behind volume one of the combined bundle. Divide of 5. Bundle 1, divide 5, page 12, foot of the page, paragraph 79. The pleading to the counterclaim, if I can call it that at the moment. As to paragraph 65, 79, is it not admitted that 7- was incorporated? 79.2, it is denied that the claimant entered into any commission or referral agreement with 7- as alleged or at all. It is denied that the defendant would be unable to reproduce a signed version of the agreement if one existed, such would be readily available from the fiduciary services provider. It is, and then it deals with the claim on its merits. So the reply in terms denies the existence of. If Your Honour's, underpinning Your Honour's concern was that I was being very careful with my wording. The reason for that is that I have a recollection that at some stage a version of the contract turned up which was signed by Miss Martel Welsh, who Your Honour may have seen reference to in the papers, and is essentially Mr. Haigh's fiduciary. But it wasn't the one that was appended to the defence. The one that was appended to the defence wasn't signed by anybody. That's actually a document that's been filed at the court. I didn't want to say there's a document which hasn't been signed by anybody for fear of my recollection being right and Mr. Haigh being able to point to an email to somebody which exhibited a half-signed contract. What has never been put forward, and which Your Honour, what Your Honour might think is particularly startling.
Well, now what I need then to see is what this document is that
yes.
He puts forward, and then you want to take me to the schedule of commissions. So I understand that your broad principle is that when you look at that document, it doesn't entitle him to the commissions anyway.
Yes. Yes.
So I need to look at it.
Yes. And we'll turn it up overnight. The schedule I can take Your Honour to immediately.
Right.
Mr. Haigh is.
Where is that?
So behind, it's in volume 3. JP6-755. So, I will take Your Honour through some of these tomorrow in a little more detail. But
I'm sorry, this is a schedule that was put forward by Mr. Haigh.
Yes.
When did he actually?
Well, this was appended to the PwC report Your Honour saw earlier and wasn't out of the paper and written on. But it reappears as a schedule to the alleged agreement.
So the agreement is meant to actually record specific entitlements.
Well, it would appear so. Now, of course, Mr. Haigh wasn't entitled to receive anything under this purported agreement until November 2013 in any event, but I'll address Your Honour on that tomorrow, if I may. This schedule lists what Mr. Haigh says he's entitled. And look at that, I'll take you on a through it. Enterprise Loan Extension is a credit facility for Leeds United, in return for which Mr. Haigh appears to be entitled, on top of his £1 million salary, to a £150,000 commission. And then a sponsorship agreement for £1 million, for which he purports to be entitled to a £100,000. He suggests he's entitled to a £16,000 commission for a £160,000 payment in respect of a BBC commentary. Then in relation to this, 23rd of October of 2013, Sport Capital Loan, and it then says, not then SC, £250,000. I'll take Your Honour through this for now. But Mr. Haigh says that he is entitled to a commission of £25,000. Now, it's worth noting, this £250,000 loan was made by Mr. Haigh from Mr. Haigh's bank account. So he appears to be alleging that he was entitled to a 10% commission for introducing himself. And then in November of 2013, there are three items. One, Sport Capital deal fee, £33.5 million. That was the sale of these by GFH. This time the commission has gone down to 1%. And he's only entitled to £335,000. Then there are two others which, even at this date, are to be confirmed. So he hasn't even agreed, but on his case, there wasn't even agreement as to the level of the commission in percentage terms. Then on the 21st of November, the next Sport Capital loan, once again, he's introducing himself. The 28th of November, Sport Capital loan, introducing to himself. Queensgate Gardens, we say, is a property investment in London, as Your Honour might imagine from the name. It has nothing whatever to do with Leeds United. But he's generous, he is only entitled to 1% on his case for that. In other words, where it's an eight-figure sum, he's only allowed 1%. But where it's smaller than that, he apparently was allowed 10%.
Says in his defence that the amount of court payments were by way of giving him commission to which he was entitled. Now, if it's as plain as day that he has no entitlement whatsoever to commission, then the summary judgment application in that respect,
yes,
is all the stronger. If it's not,
well, we say it is plain as day.
Yeah. You're not going to do it by going through it the way you're just doing it.
I'm sorry?
You're not going to do that by going through things the way you are now doing them.
Yes. The commissions are not clearly identified by Mr. Haigh in his defence. So, when I say how did it become plain today, well, I begin with the defence itself. Bearing in mind that this is a fiduciary who is required to work for the benefit of his principal, who says his principal agreed to the payment of millions of pounds.
Well, he says he has an agreement.
He does say that.
If he did, then we're not in the bribe situation at all.
Well, if his case is right, and there was an agreement with his corporate vehicle that he should be entitled to millions of dirhams, then he may have a counterclaim. He has a procedural issue in that he never paid the issuing fee to make a counterclaim.
It's not just a counterclaim.
But so far as...
Hang on. It's not just a counterclaim because he says that these payments were to satisfy his entitlement to commission.
Yes.
He says he uses it as a defence.
Well, and that's what I was coming to. The question Your Honour puts... first question one puts to me is, if he has a valid agreement for the payment of commission, then surely how can Your Honour decide, or may have, how could Your Honour award summary judgment on the issue? Now, so far as that is concerned, but it's not actually a defence. The fact of the agreement in itself does not, in fact, answer the claim.
What, why not?
Because
if it be right that these payments were to satisfy an entitlement to commission, how does it answer the question?
Because that's the point. That's the point.
Your case has to be that for other reasons, these payments cannot have been made to satisfy any entitlement that there may have been to commission.
Perhaps, Your Honour, I wasn't being clear, I'm sorry. There are two parts to this commission issue. The first is whether there was an agreement at all. And we say, clearly not. The second is whether any of the payments into his bank account, supported by a wholly fraudulent audit trail, or at least arguably, payments of any entitlements under that agreement. Now, what that means is, if that be Mr. Haigh's case, then in order to find in his favour a trial, court must conclude that it is more likely than not that the following sequence of events happened. First, there was an agreement between Mr. Haigh and his employer that in addition to what he says about a seven-figure salary and expenses package at Leeds United, plus the other money put forward as salary and expenses, the claimant agreed that he would be entitled to millions of pounds in commission. It paid a small proportion of those commissions, but it did so misdescribing them when they paid it into his bank account as professional fees. And rather than ascribing these payments to the contract they had concluded with Mr. Haigh, they set about, for reasons unexplained, creating a completely fraudulent audit trail, which is tainted by four suppliers, three out of the four suppliers, because this issue of the commissions keeps raising its head in every respect except Milnet, which was either rent or a mistake. So, it's not just that Mr. Haigh has to explain how it comes about that he can't produce a signed copy of the contract. It's that having reached this agreement, if his case be right, not only was it breached by the claimant, but they set about concealing the fact that they were honouring it in any way, shape or form. Now, that's a remarkable state of affairs, one which is inherently unlikely in my submission. And so it's not really where is the evidence with which we knock out the claim. One might say, where is the evidence which starts to get this defence off the ground, even? And evidence comes there none, regrettably. And evidence comes there none, no signed agreement. No recognition that any debts have crystallized. No communications recording this agreement. No invoices from Mr. Haigh to reconcile the payment to the agreement. No demands by Mr. Haigh, where are my commissions? Where are my commissions? The PwC report exhibits a WhatsApp conversation between Mr. Haigh and Mr. R. Reyes, which I'll take you on at 2 in the morning. But that's it. Not a single piece of paper. where a contract has been concluded ostensibly between a company, 7-3, and the claimant, by which the claimant's deputy chief executive will receive, on his case, millions of pounds. And instead of such a document trail, we have a wholly fraudulent invoice trail and wholly fraudulent payments, internal payment instructions. My submission is that the defence simply doesn't get off the ground. But I see the time.
Yes, well, that might be an appropriate time. I'm not too sure whether, in the light of what you've just said, you'll want to go all that much further into trying to show that he's not entitled to any commissions anyway.
You want to take the point. We will endeavour to dig out the 7-3 agreement, because it is right, it's exhibited to the defence, it should be before your bridge. That was an oversight. But it may well be, once again, as one goes to the evidence, or the lack of it in this case, becomes of assistance. I don't anticipate being too much longer tomorrow morning.
Well, thank you very much. We'll resume things at 10 o'clock tomorrow.
Yes, and my instructor for this helpfully reminds me I should do a checklist of the things that we should
produce. Yes, there are a few other things which I hope I have a note of, but I'm sure that...
I think you'd like the confirmation. The first is the 7-3 agreement. The second is proof of service on the 17th of March.
Yes.
The
engagement.
And the third is the appointment terms.
Longer terms.
Yes, but we'll pull out those off. Yes, you're right. And the lease plan.
Sorry, let me just check one other thing. Demonstrate the service of Mr. Patel's statement back in.
Yes, that's the service, by the way. Service point.
Got that. I think that's it. Thank you. 10 o'clock tomorrow.
All rise.